In the Synoptic Gospels, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, there are a few dozen parables that Jesus tells us. Of course, parables are these stories that are designed to teach us from as we read them, as we learn from them, as we put ourselves in these stories. And a couple of those parables that we are familiar with, one of them is the Pharisee and the tax collector. If you're not familiar with this one, I'll give you just a brief reminder of what this is. You have two men go into the temple. One is a Pharisee, one is a tax collector. The Pharisee goes in and says, "Lord, thank you so much for making me me. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you that I'm not like those other people. Thank you that I tithe and I give gifts. Thank you, God, that I'm not like that tax collector sitting over there. Thank you, thank you, thank you." And then you have the tax collector sitting there who doesn't even look up to God, bows his head and says, "Have mercy on me, a sinner." And so as we think about this parable, we put ourselves into the roles of the people in the parables. And we often think we probably should be that tax collector who's there, humble, asking God for grace, asking God for mercy and forgiveness. But how often do we find ourselves as the Pharisee saying, "God, I'm so glad I'm me and not like those awful people over there." Another parable that we look at a lot is the parable of the prodigal son. Again, you have generally three people that we look at in this parable. You have a father, and you have an older son, and you have a younger son. And the younger son goes up to the father and he says to the father, "Dad, I want my inheritance now and I'm leaving." Which effectively means, "Dad, you're dead to me. I want to go." This is a very serious, serious thing that he's saying to his father. And the father gives the younger son the inheritance. And the younger son goes off and he squanders everything that his dad gave him. And in kind of a double whammy situation, after he squanders everything, there's this famine that sweeps across the land. So he's really in trouble. So the younger son finds a job. He's feeding the pigs of the people in the area. And he wishes that he could just eat what he was feeding the pigs. And he comes to a point where he realizes, well, this is really dumb. Why am I doing this? I can go back to my father and ask to be a servant. And so that's what he does. And he doesn't go back to his dad asking to be restored as a son. He goes back knowing that he did something that was wrong, something he shouldn't have done, and just wants to work so he can eat. But his father sees him from a ways off, and the father runs out to him and gives him a big old hug and orders the servant to put a coat over him and to kill the fattened calf so they can have a feast that night. And so the younger son is restored to the father. Then the older son hears about this. He's coming back to the house from the field, and he says, what's going on up there? And one of the servants says, "Well, your younger brother has returned, and your father is having a feast." And what's the older brother's reaction? He gets angry, doesn't he? He thinks, "Dad, how could you forgive him for doing what he did? He disowned you. He ran away from you. How could you possibly take him back in?" And so when we look at the parable of the prodigal son, so often we will picture ourselves as that younger son who did something that, well, shouldn't have really done. And we understand that we too are sinners, that we have done things we shouldn't have done. And we go to our Father, our loving Father in heaven, and we're just trying to be humble and get something, get a meal. And instead of just simply working for God, he takes us back and brings us back into the family. But we also need to look at ourselves, especially in that parable, as the Father also, don't we? This loving Father, when someone wrongs us, as difficult as it is, can we embrace them again as a brother? Do we find ourselves as that older brother who's angry about the forgiveness that's given? How can you forgive this person for what they did? It was such a terrible thing. And you're just welcoming them back in. And so we need to put ourselves into that role as well. So with any of the parables that we look at, we have to identify with those people who are in these stories that Jesus tells us. And we must also look at and identify with the people being written to in the epistles, in the letters throughout the rest of the New Testament. So here in Hebrews, we must connect with the recipients of this letter. And we have to remind ourselves that we in the 21st century are very much like the people in the first century that got this letter. We are very much in the same boat, struggling oftentimes in our faith in Jesus Christ. When I was at NDSU, I was in band. Many of you know that. I bought that bass when I was at NDSU, and that's been a long time to finally break a string on that thing. But I was in music, and when you're in music, as with a lot of organizations, you get really close to one another in the band. And I'm sure it's the same way in choir and orchestra and everything like that. But musicians have something in common, and there's a lot of collective working together in that ensemble that you have to do. And so band people become friends with other band people. And some band people become really, really close friends with other band people. And sometimes when those band people get really, really close friends with other band people, they make little band babies. And I had some friends in band, they had a little band baby when I was in college. And just a cute little girl. And he recently posted on Facebook, the dad said, "Hey, if you guys want to feel old, my daughter just turned 16. It's like, yeah, I feel a lot older now, I guess. But anyway, it was probably a few months after their daughter was born, our group was out probably for dinner, probably at Buffalo Wild Wings. I don't know where we were at, but mom, and they had their little girl with them. Mom and one of the other people in our group were chatting. And the one other woman asked, "Mom, is your daughter on eating cereal yet?" And me being a dumb guy, I'm thinking, are you giving a 3-month-old Lucky Charms? Like, that doesn't make any sense. Right? But I didn't say anything. It's like, I don't know. I'm not a parent. I didn't know if that was maybe appropriate. Maybe 3-year-olds or 3-month-olds love Frosted Flakes and whatnot. But fortunately, I wasn't the only dumb guy sitting at the table. And somebody else said, "Man, are you really giving that kid Cheerios already? That doesn't seem right." But then they explained to us that it's not cereal like we think of it. It's the next progression of baby food, right? So you go from, what do you start with? You start with milk or formula. You progress to cereal, which is what, mushy something that doesn't look real appetizing to an adult. But it's part of the development process for a child. And in our Christian life, we have this development as well. And our author of Hebrews uses this example, as do Paul and Peter uses it also, of drinking milk before progressing on to solid food. Now, when it comes to Christian maturity, there isn't necessarily anything inherently wrong with being an immature Christian. Because if you went out and you grilled up a nice steak and you boiled some potatoes and you mashed them up with some butter and some garlic, you set it out on the table, and then you plopped your 3-month-old down in front of it, would you get angry if they didn't pick up the knife, start cutting the steak and eating the steak and potatoes? No, of course not. I hope not. People need to develop. And as kids develop, as kids grow, they start eating some different things. But often they still need a little bit of help. When Junior starts eating hot dogs, do you just put a hot dog on a plate and let him take a big bite of it? No, you cut it up, right? How old is Junior when you start giving him hot dogs? 3 years old, maybe? Does that sound about right? 2? Okay, 2 years old. So you cut them up. Why do you cut them up? So they don't choke, of course. The same thing with grapes, right? Grapes are just this perfect size and shape to get caught in a child's windpipe. We don't want that to happen, so you're going to cut up the grapes for your little 2-year-old as well. Now, we don't blame that child for not being able to eat grapes or hot dogs without choking. We know that it's a problem for them. We know it's an issue, so we help them out by cutting it up. We don't expect that 3-month-old to eat a steak. We don't expect a two-year-old to eat a whole hot dog without getting a little help from mom or dad. But once a child gets to a certain point, once they master a task, then they can graduate on to the next step. But there is no expectation of our kids skipping these milestones. And it is the same for us in our Christian walk. The first thing you have to do is the basics of the basics. Repent, admit you are a sinner, ask for forgiveness, and know that Jesus died for you. The basics of the basics. Romans 10, verse 9 says, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The basics of the basics for salvation. This is the milk of the gospel. How can we progress beyond that point without learning the foundation first? We cannot. Think of it this way. God enables us to get to a certain point. Let's call that point A. Let's say I'm at point A. The next step for me is point B. And so God has this area that I have to cover. And so I slowly get there, and I finally get to point B. And then I get to point C. He opens up point C for me. So I creep along, and I get to point C. And then he reveals to me point D. And I can keep moving on and moving and moving. So A to B to C to D. But the thing is, we can't skip the points. If we start at point A and we want to get to point C, we can't just go A to C. We have to go A to B to C. You see what I'm getting at here? And that is how we grow into Christian maturity. And once you understand the basics, that Jesus died for you and you need him for salvation, and once you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, then you can mature into the understanding of why. Yes, Jesus died on the cross for us. Yes, Jesus rose from the dead. Yes, Jesus ascended into heaven, opening a path for us to follow. And when we dig deeper, we see that Jesus died during the festival of Passover, right? We're approaching our time of Easter, of Maundy Thursday, of Good Friday. Jesus died during the festival of Passover. This festival celebrated God bringing the Israelites out of Egypt. Specifically, God sparing the Israelites from the plague of the death of the firstborn. If you want more on that, go ahead back and read from Exodus in the Old Testament. And they were spared because God told them through Moses to sacrifice a lamb and paint that blood of the lamb on the doorframe of their house. Remember what they were supposed to use? Hyssop. Yes, a hyssop branch. And then death would pass over this home and all would be spared in that house. And so now we can make the connection that it was the blood of the lamb sacrificed that signaled death to pass over the home of the Israelites. And that it was the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, that was shed on the cross, that tells death, eternal death, to pass over us, because we have been cleansed by that blood. There is more to this story, there's more symbolism, there's more connections to the Old Testament. There's more to the story of Jesus' death on the cross, his resurrection, his ascension into heaven, that people can begin to see as they grow closer to God, as they grow in Christ Jesus, and as they progress to the solid food of the gospel. But it all starts with the milk, and that's okay. The problem the author is addressing here in Hebrews is that the recipients of this letter are still drinking the milk when they should be eating solid food. Like we said, we don't have a problem cutting up hot dogs for our two-year-old because that's what's safe, right? But if you're still cutting up hot dogs for Junior when he's 14, we're going to start to have a problem. I'm not talking about a legitimate developmental disability. These are things that happen. I mean someone that should have progressed to the next stage and simply hasn't. either because they don't want to, they're lazy, they think they're good enough, they think they have enough ability or knowledge, they just refuse to move on to the next stage. You remember being about 17, 18 years old, ready to graduate from high school, and you were really, 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 really ready to move out of mom and dad's house? Do you remember being 16 or so and really, really, really ready to get your driver's license and a car? Those were things in your development, in your life, that meant freedom to you. They were the steps of growth in your life from childhood into adulthood. And our recipients of this letter aren't hitting the milestones they should be hitting in their Christian growth. They're 14 and mom is still cutting their hot dogs for them. And the author tells us why. Chapter 5, verse 11 says, "We have much to say about this, but it is hard to make it clear to you because you no longer try to understand." You no longer try to understand. They are stuck because they want to be stuck. They are perfectly content being inappropriately immature. God has laid out for them their point B. They're at point A. God's laid out for them their point B. But they're perfectly happy at point A. And they're not moving toward point B. They're still stuck at point A. God has said to them, "You're ready to move." But they refuse to move. And this was a problem for first century Christians, and this is still a problem for 21st century Christians. Keep in mind also that length of time as a Christian does not relate to maturity. One can be a Christ follower for just a few years and have gone from point A to point B to point C to point D and so on. Conversely, one could have been a Christian for 30, 40, 50 years or more and not progressed past point B or even point A. If you've been a Christ follower for 6 months or 6 years or 60 years, how does one overcome being stuck? How does one overcome simply being content in our infancy of belief? Commentator Ray Stedman gives us some steps that we can follow to go from A to B to C to D. He tells us that step one is to begin with truth you already know but have not been obeying. Does God want you to stop some activity you know to be wrong? I would also add, does God want you to start some activity that you know to be right? Does Scripture exhort you to change your attitude, forgive someone, or reach out with help to another? No further light will be given until you begin to obey the light you already have. I'm going to repeat that for you. No further light will be given until you begin to obey the light you already have. If you get nothing else from this message today, I want you to remember that phrase. Let that statement sink in. No further light will be given until you begin to obey the light you already have. Step two in our progress. Review the promises of God for help from on high to obey His word. And we have a couple of those promises here in Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18 says, "Because He Himself suffered when He was tempted, He is able to help those who are being tempted." And in chapter 4, we're reminded, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." These are the promises that God is giving us. Step three, take those promises, claim them for yourself. Do whatever you need to do and count on God's grace to see you through the consequences. In other words, trust that God will do for you what He promises to do for you. And step four is follow this procedure whenever you become aware of areas in your life and thinking that need to be changed. He says, this is the constant use which will enable one to grow and to handle the solid food of the teaching about righteousness. The Apostle Paul in Ephesians says, then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head, that is, Christ. These are the steps that we can take to get from A to B, and then from B to C, and then C to D, and so on. Therefore, let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward to maturity, not laying again the foundation of repentance from acts that lead to death, and of faith in God, instruction about the cleansing rites, the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment, and God permitting, we will do so. A life with Christ is not, cannot be, it must not be a stagnant life. There is forever progression from A to B to C to D. And this necessitates growth and change. Not change for the sake of change, but change for the sake of glorifying God. Remaining a spiritual infant, refusing to seek a taste of the solid food of the gospel, is to deny Christ's plan for your life. It is to say, I know more than you do, God. My plan is better than yours. Strive to eat the solid food. Strive to eat the solid food. Now that we're through the easy part of the message, let's move on to these three very difficult verses. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 4 through 6. It is impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the powers of the coming age, and who have fallen away, to be brought back to repentance. To their loss, they are crucifying the Son of God all over again and subjecting Him to public disgrace. It was probably close to 2 months ago that we went over this in our Sunday school class. And we spent a couple weeks on just these few verses. And the meaning of these few verses varies greatly depending on who you ask. One camp will say, well, if someone has fallen away from God, that means that they never knew God in the first place. They never were truly a Christ follower, since once someone, when they truly become a Christian, they cannot fall away. They cannot lose their salvation. Another side will say, well, right here is proof that even one that claims Christ, one that knows Christ, can lose salvation if they reject Jesus later on. Well, if, as one group says, those that fall away never truly knew Christ to begin with, what about this statement about it being impossible to be brought back into repentance? When one is presented with the gospel, the good news of salvation through Christ Jesus, if they reject the message, doesn't that tell us that they can never come to know Christ in the future? Doesn't that mean they miss their chance? They've been enlightened, they've had a taste, yet they've still rejected Christ. Does that mean that they will never have another chance? Well, let me tell you, my friends, if that's the case, I have not truly entered into relationship with Christ. Remember the testimony that I gave about a month and a half ago now? In high school, I was right here, sitting in this sanctuary, listening to Pastor Bob Cheatham preach the Word of God, preach Christ crucified, Jesus is salvation, preach that right from this pulpit, right here. I heard that message, right here. Despite that, one night I came to totally lose my faith in God. I became an atheist. Based on that interpretation that we talked about a second ago, I do not have the Holy Spirit within me. because it would have been impossible for me to have been brought back into repentance because I heard the message and I rejected it. And if that's true, I'm not sure what's in me right now preaching Christ to you. I'm not sure what's in me right now urging you to follow Jesus. What about those that accepted Christ, fell away, but did come back into repentance? Did they really lose their salvation for the time that they fell away? And if they did, wouldn't they have been precluded from receiving it back? Well, based on the idea that one can lose their salvation, and what is presented here, that if someone falls away, they can't be restored, well, maybe that person only mostly lost their salvation, only partially turned away from God? Remember the balloon analogy from a couple weeks ago that I did about the Holy Spirit balloon? Well, maybe if that Holy Spirit shrinks so much because of the outside pressure on it, it never totally goes away. It's just so incredibly small, and the person didn't truly reject God, but they had that little bit of Holy Spirit left in them. And since it rebloomed, it grew back, meaning they were never truly lost. One was never truly saved and they fell away. One fell away, but they didn't completely fall away, so they were able to come back. One was saved, they fell away, they completely rejected Jesus, and they'll never have the chance to come back to him. But perhaps this passage has a narrower focus than we think. Our author of Hebrews has just finished talking about becoming mature Christians. Remember also, our author has spoken much to this point of the desire of the Israelites to go back to Egypt, where they had food and shelter, but they forgot about being in bondage. They talked about going back to Egypt instead of pushing forward through the wilderness and into the promised land. Is the author actually giving a hypothetical warning to the recipients of this letter? Is he saying, keep pushing forward, keep maturing in Christ so that you don't fall away? He's saying, don't look back, because these bad things can happen if you aren't careful. Make sure you are constantly striving to draw closer to the Lord so you don't find yourself in a position to lose your faith. You don't find yourself in a position to fall away. What does the author really mean here? And what does it mean for those that we love that may have heard the gospel but not yet responded? Or those that we love that have heard the gospel and have appeared to have fallen away? This is a question that has been discussed and debated for close to 2,000 years now. You can find plenty of commentaries and papers and articles on what these few verses mean. You can ask 20 different pastors, 20 different missionaries, 20 different theologians, 20 different educators, and I guarantee you, you'll get 20 different answers. In one of the commentaries that I have, for just these three verses, there are 30 pages of notes. About 5% of this commentary is for these three verses. And the truth is, I don't really have any other way to answer this for you today, other than to say, I don't have the answer. And it's probably not what you wanted to hear after me speaking on these verses now for the last little while. But I want us to be comforted by this. The author finishes this section by reminding us the incredible love that God has for us. Chapter 6, starting in verse 9. Even though we speak like this, dear friends, we are convinced of better things in your case, the things that have to do with salvation. God is not unjust. He will not forget the work and the love you have shown him as you have helped his people and continue to help them. We want each of you to show this same diligence to the very end so that what you hope for may be fully realized. We do not want you to become lazy, but to imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised. God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown him as you have helped his people and continue to help them. The ultimate truth is that coming into a saving relationship with Christ is vital. And once we enter that relationship, continual growth, a steady maturing in our faith is vital so we won't fall back into our old ways. So we don't desire to go back to where we were. We must not cry out, back to Egypt. But we must cry out, forward to the promised land. God is just. God is faithful. God knows your heart. God's promise will never fail. And on that promise is where we'll start next week. Let's close in prayer.